So read this first or
open your meeting first and then read
this.
Yep.
Right, good evening members. I now declare the Strategies, Planning and Partnerships Committee meeting open Tuesday, 8th of December. The Strategy, Planning and Partnerships Committee and the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee and the Economic and Community Development Committee and the Finance and Business Services Committee, as we have all four committees this evening. The public meetings will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of these meetings. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the Council, including transferring outside of Australia. The Strategy, Planning and Partnerships Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of Adelaide Plains and pays respect to Elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Thank you, members. Apologies and leave of absence. Agenda item 2, the Right Honourable Lord Mayor Martin Hazy is an apology. And is everyone else here?
Yes.
That is good. Excellent. Agenda item number 3, confirmation of minutes. May I have someone move the minutes from the 3rd of November? Deputy Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Slama. Any discussions? Members, I'll put that. All those in favour, declare those minutes carried. Thank you. We have no public forum, agenda item number 4. My verbal report, I'll be brief. We've got a pretty hefty agenda for all four committees this evening. But I'll just take this opportunity as the chair of the first committee meeting to acknowledge, and for those that haven't had the update, that Sandy Bashaw received the highest number of votes to take the area councillor vacancy. So congratulations to her. I'm sure we all extend that on behalf of this council, and also congratulations to all of the candidates that participated in the election. They all worked very hard. Members, I'm also just going to add, we've had a conversation lately about agenda items that are pulled out, giving the staff the opportunity to introduce and identify any key points to give context to those agenda items. So I believe best to start straight away and do that. And so we will work with that kind of discussion this evening. So I look forward to the contribution from the staff there. Members, I now call for items for adoption on block. Item number 7, Gresham Place Public Realm Enhancement. Are you pulling that out, Councillor Martin?
I am.
Needs it to be. Item number 8, Heritage Investigations Process. You pulling that out, Councillor Wilkinson? Item number 9, Residential Main Street Development Plan Amendment Part 2. Item number 10, Adelaide Oval Proposed Changes to Adelaide Oval Number 2. Item number 11, Variations to the Adelaide Parklands Plan. Item number 12, Submission to the Liquor Licensing Discussion Paper. Yep. Councillor Hender. Item number 13, Oban City Access Project. Item number 14, there is nil. Item number 15, which is a bit odd, I'm not sure how to, you know, 15 is out of session papers to note.
That's a question to ask.
Councillor Martin. Okay, so members, I'm calling for a mover for items 9, 10, 11 and 13. Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Members, I'll put those items, all those in favour, declare that carried. Thank you. I'll go to item number seven, Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair.
Are you moving as printed or?
Moving as.
Okay, thank you. Do I have a second, please? Councillor Slammer?
I just have a couple of questions related to the development. What is the contribution, because it's not clear, what is the likely contribution from Andor Capital, which is the principal beneficiary of the development, to the project as noted at 16?
Through the chair, I'll get Andor to answer that question.
So the likely contribution at the moment stands at 50% of what's estimated to be a $500,000 runway project, so it's approximately $250,000.
Well, it's the next question, because I wasn't sure whether the reference to the cost as $533,000 was representative of that project alone or the three that were mentioned.
Through the chair, the point three, the $283,000 co-funding is all three co-funding projects.
So all three co-funded projects are 283, but this one is $500,000.
Yes, it's my lion's share of those projects. The other two co-funded projects are small, far outside of the Halifax, and then the hotel, which I need to put across the
And just one final question, just not clear to the documents. The bollards, they are removable.
That's to be intended to be held behind, if there could be a different removal.
So members, and there'll be more detail on the actual projects, and about this particular agenda item is about the closure of the street. There's a lot, I understand the detailed design will be coming back to this council for the actual project in itself and budget consideration. Right, Councillor Stanley was a second member. Councillor Martin, can I say summed up?
Summed up.
Lovely. Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? So that carried. Thank you. Councillor Wilkinson, item number eight. I did say I was going to get staff to highlight any key points. Did you want to David, add anything new? Or?
Through the chair, I think it's just worth noting that what we're seeking to do through this report is to finalise the residential on Main Street DPA, noting that we have had advice regarding the Manitoba. Site being listed.
This is council item number
8. Sorry, I jumped forward.
Item number 9 has already gone through, so.
Sorry, the heritage investigations progress really is about noting the tourism potential and the value for heritage across the city and what value that could be looked at. What the report also seeks to do is highlight that. Part two of the city centre heritage aspect is still outstanding. In fact, it expires in March. And given where we are with the planning reform bill, it's important that council seeks consideration of the minister to extend those protections during this period while the bill is being considered. Otherwise, they will expire in March.
Welcome, Michael David, Councillor Wilkinson.
The imperative of Adelaide's heritage and character, its tourism appeal. And what's interesting to note, you know, we've just dealt with something about Gresham Street, but, you know, there's a great little new French bar in Gresham Street, which I sent a photo to members of. Fantastic little bar, examples of bars like that, which are really fantastic, attractive. When you go to the cities around the world, somewhere in France, you know, oh, it's a great little bar, that lovely stone character, really funky, and they're always in the little old buildings. But that little French building in Gresham Street was one that I had put up for listings. That I don't think that was even recommended by our own consultants, not even on the 251. That well, maybe that one is, but the clever little tailor in Peel Street, you know, John Rowe would hold that up as a triumph. But that building, that wasn't even in the 251, you know. There are about 300 buildings in CBD that should have been put up. Only 250 were recommended. John Rowe listed just 37, 14% of them. Yet all of those popular little places that people love about the city, they're all in these historic buildings, and virtually none of them are protected. The entire south side of Weymouth Street, all bar two buildings in Peel Street aren't listed. None of the buildings in Gresham Street, just that lovely bluestone building in Bank Street, just demolished. That could have been another great little bar in our laneway thing. They're all talking about the fermentation. So the tourist, that's just south of all our tourist route, you know, from the Oval up to the markets and stuff like that. So it's a great piece of work, and important that you've done this work and that we can present it to particularly the relevant ministers and governments, so they can start to see Adelaide's historic buildings as an asset, not as a chain around the neck of progress to be capitalised on, not cleared away. So thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Yes, a great report indeed. The seconder was Councillor Moran.
Just to support what Sandy said.
Councillor Hender.
Yeah, I also wanted to thank the staff for this piece of work, and because I think it positions heritage where it ought to be positioned, that is, as an economic driver for the city. But I don't think I need to move an amendment, but can I just make a comment that I think we should really widen the audience for this, the Economic Development Board, the Minister for Cities, anyone who's got an economic interest in the city ought to be seeing this, because I think the more people who understand the economic value of our heritage, the better. So commend the staff for the work and that's been done in it, and to the Councillor Wilkinson, who I know has a passion for this. But for me, this is really about getting the story of our heritage positioned in the right spot, because I think we can get some better traction if we get it up here as an economic driver.
Councillor Curran.
Thank you. Yes, I certainly welcome this report. It's very sad that we actually have to put a dollar value on our cultural heritage in order for it to be valued. But if that's what it takes, so be it. I mean, Blind Freddy knows that a lot of Australians pack their bags and go off to other places because of the cultural heritage attractions there. We just seem to be blinded by our very own, but it's only when we've got other people from other places that tell us how wonderful our cultural heritage is that we suddenly start to think about our own, which I think is a bit sad. But if that's what it takes, so be it. Yes, indeed, we do need to better acknowledge the value of our heritage and also get the story out there.
Thank you. Councillor Wilkinson, can I say that summed up? Or?
Well,
you'd allow me to. Summed up. That's what I was alluding to. Lovely. Thank you. All members, I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Councillor Hender, item number 12.
To move as printed.
Move as printed. Can I have a second, please? Councillor Slammer.
Thank you. I just wanted to draw on the opportunity that exists as virtue of, I think it's paragraph 1.4 of the motion, which is that the Chief Executive Officer can finalise submissions and do editorial work. And I've just got one minor editorial issue on page 209, which is, you'll find in the first paragraph of page 209. It's about the ability of the public to raise concerns regarding high impact applications at the licensing stage. And at the moment, our submission says the public should be able to do that until the planning and development code is developed. I believe our public should be able to do that anyway. And so I think that was actually the intent. It just needs the removal of those words until the planning and development code is developed. And I've spoken to administration about that, who understand my point about it, and they have indicated to me that was always the intent. What really they were saying, this is a holding pattern, but it's their view, and council's express view, that this is something to go on beyond into the future.
So let's just get some comment from Claire Mockman.
Through the chair, that is correct, councillor. And we're happy to remove that because obviously it's an important principle that the community has their say.
Is there anything else you wanted to bring to the attention of members on this particular item, Claire? Councillor Martin?
Yes, thank you. And in a similar vein, I'd just like to urge the administration to argue more strongly for a share of the proposed licence fee income than is the case at 26. On page 195, the fact is that our costs are significantly higher than you would expect in licensing matters, particularly with the requirement to monitor premises and most likely from the new regulations to be responsible for the monitoring of noise levels up until midnight, 7 days a week. And so therefore, there is a legitimate case to argue for a substantial share of licence fees. And I think if we could reflect that, that would be good. Now, just two other quick points I wanted to make. One is that the submission, and I endorse the submission, but one is that I note the recommendation for the state and the Commonwealth, that is the urging for them to work together to come up with a higher unit price for alcohol. But it's also the availability, and Councillor Wilkinson has raised on several occasions, that the hours at which bulk wine particularly is sold at certain locations has a strong correlation with the state of drunkenness of individuals. And so that ought to be a part of this mission. As well as, I'm not certain about the argument in relation to supermarkets. As it is proposed, it's suggested that if wine is sold in supermarkets, then that sale ought to stop at 9 p.m. on weekdays and 5 p.m. on Saturdays, which is in fact the time they close. The issue is in fact the mornings. Again, that is to say, if alcohol is sold in bulk in casks or whatever in the early hours of the day at supermarkets, but if it's discouraged in other liquor outlets, then it fits the purpose of the original intention.
Do you want to actually the question in terms of getting some clarity on?
No, I'm just asking if that could be considered. I think reasonable thing.
Could that be taken on notice or?
Yeah, so through the chair, we can certainly tighten that along the words you've outlined, Councillor. And in terms of progressing Councillor Wilkinson's motion from earlier this year regarding sales in the city, that's also being progressed through this mechanism, but as well as ongoing discussions with the senior officers group.
That's great, thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Councillor Thurman.
In relation to the development plan being replaced by the design code, new planning and design code, and the recommendation that liquor licences be processed at the planning stage, and given that they're looking at more mixed use approach to planning rather than specific zoning areas which now exist, what are the likely impacts of licensing in relation to in those with entertainment consent and extended operating hours, in particular near residential areas? Will there still be the opportunities for council and residents to actually respond to these concerns? Or is it just going to be, given also that our planning is not likely to be in the hands of, like our current development assessment panel, but in some hands-off distant body,
what are the likely outcomes of that? I mean, you know, my concern is that it's removing it from the community. It also is putting it in the hands of people who aren't going to be affected or involved. Do we have confidence in this system to manage those impacts? I know it's a hard question.
Welcome, David.
Just through the chair, I guess, just in general terms, there's a review of the planning system going on currently and a review of the licensing system going on. And they're both being led by the Attorney General, Minister for Planning. And so there's reform happening on both. In simple terms, it's envisaged that the planning and design code will replace the development plan. Just in saying that, the planning and design code, nobody's seen it. It in effect is creating a new set of zoning policies for the whole state. And it will take a couple of years to develop. So I think we'd be speculating, I guess, but I certainly share there's a need for a very balanced approach to balance amenity and activity. And it varies in different spots, but certainly in those spots of the city, Connell Street, people living nearby, that's a key area. There will always need to be balanced in terms of, you know, the policy settings in that sense. But tied in with this is, of course, the need to try to make it efficient for providers to get approvals. But it is quite complex currently, so it's trying to just see how can we streamline. And so it might be that both systems work a bit closer together, but there's a lot of water, just an awful lot of water, we're still under the bridge.
And just another point for clarification.
Can you use your microphone, please?
Another point for clarification. In terms of the mixed use approach, will that be applied to the residential areas, or will there still be some fairly strong delineation between the mixed use zones and, for example, the residential zone?
Through the chair, it's. I think a lot of that will come down to what things like the 30-year plan say about the future of the city. I mean, currently there's a fairly clear delineation between residential areas of the city which have a degree of mixed use. The extent to which that mixed use will get more mixed, if that makes sense. But the capital city part of the city is envisaged to be very mixed use. And so in the big scheme of things, I think that delineation will largely continue. But it's, you know, the debates about how mixed use residential areas should be, those things are still continue.
Thank you, David. So no other queries or speakers, Councillor Hendo?
Really, just to sum up, but also to reassure Councillor Clarehan, was the point that Councillor Clarehan raised was really the point I was trying to make. And the sentence that I'm wanting us to have in our submission is that the public should always be able to raise their concerns regarding high impact application at the licensing stage. And for the very reasons that you've just described, I think it's critical that we, if we're going to loosen up our licensing, that we don't lose sight of the fact that licenses have to sit alongside human beings who want to live normal lives. And we've all been to cities where that works really well, and many of us have been to cities where it doesn't work well at all. And we need to make sure that our city falls into the first category, where licensed premises are easily obtained, but that are low impact. And I think that's doable, but we need to keep our eye on that ball, which is why I made the amendment that I did. Sorry, nothing further to say other than to commend the work and hope that we get our message through to the state government.
Thank you, Councillor Hender. Members, I'll put that. All those in favour, declare that carried. I now go to item number 15. Councillor Martin, you have a question. Are you moving the papers to note?
Yeah, sure.
And I have a seconder, please. Councillor Moran, fire away.
Yeah, my question relates to 3, the draft Adelaide Parklands Management Strategy, which I understand came before council for noting recently, is here before committee for noting, but which has not been considered by council. Now, given that it includes substantial projects, including squaring Victoria Square, building in Victoria Park, building in Park 4 North Adelaide, an investigation into the extension of West Terrace Cemetery, a new land bridge across Donald Bradman Drive, a new bridge across the rail lines near Bonython Park, conversion of Sir Lewis's Cohen Drive into a shared pedestrian vehicle zone, and a cafe or kiosk in Brougham Gardens, all involving substantial cost, capital cost. How do we manage the expectation that the people who are being consulted, that these things might actually come to fruition?
Through the chair, through the consultation process and also in as part of the engagement, as part of the soft launch with the release of this document, we've been very clear that it is an uncosted plan of aspirations for the parklands that have been developed by the Adelaide Parklands Authority under the Parklands Act.
Are we saying specifically these things may never happen?
Through the chair, we're just saying that it is currently an uncosted plan. There is, in the new year, the intent to develop an implementation plan, which will look at finalising the prioritisation aspect of these and the financial implications associated with those priorities.
And that's when council will get the chance to say we approve of this or we disapprove.
Through the chair, the plan itself, the strategy itself, is a strategy that is developed by the authority. It is their plan, but it does not come into effect under the legislation until both the minister and council sign off on it. That will include prioritisation and costing to projects.
Thank you. Yes, I understand. Thank you.
Members, no other questions on the out-of-session information papers. I'll put the, summed up. Councillor Martin, was that?
Summed up.
Put that, all those in favour? Declare that carried. Members, do I have any other business? Councillor Clarahan?
Madam Chair, I just wanted to add to your comment and congratulations on the election of Sandy Vershaw. And just raise another issue, which is quite significant, and that is probably the first time in the 175 years of the existence of this council, we now have gender balance. Woohoo!
Thank you, Councillor Clarahan. Girl power. Members, there are no items seeking inclusion of the public, so I will now close the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, also, she'll be sworn in at the 15th of December meeting. There isn't a separate process.
You know, that's not technically a question, or am I? Special occasion. I think we can set aside standing orders for that.
Thank you.
Members, I declare the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee meeting open. Public in the gallery, the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee public meeting will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of these meetings. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the Council, including transferring outside Australia. Acknowledgement of country. The Infrastructure and Public Space Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders, past and present. We respect and recognise their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continued importance to the Kaurna people living today. Apologies and leave of absence. Lord Mayor, thank you. Confirmation of minutes. Do I have a motion? Deputy Lord Mayor Abiyad. Seconder. Councillor Clarahan. All those in favour? Those opposed? Declare that passed. Thank you. Public forum. We have no items on the public forum. Chair's verbal report. I have some matters in relation to the Test Street item, but as Chair, I'm not in a position to do anything, so I just flag that when this comes to Council, I will be raising my suggestions how we might permanently approach that. So just to flag that that particular item. Items for adoption on block. I now go through the items. Item 7, update to acquisition of disposal of land and infrastructure asset policies. Councillor Martin. Item 8, Chester Street landscape assets. Councillor Martin. Item 9, parklands leasing and licensing company. Councillor Martin. Item 10, declare publicly unnamed private road west of Register Street. Item 11, Wilcox, Little Sturt and Chatham Street design option. Site plan review. Item 12, waste.
Item 13, items for committee to receive and note nil. Item 14, out of session information papers to note. I'll be calling them out. Okay, I will now call out items, put items 10 and 12 and 13. I'll ask for a mover to move those. Councillor Slaman, seconder, Councillor Martin. I put that. All those in favour? All those opposed? Deem that carried. Now, Councillor Martin, item 7. Update to acquisition of disposal of land and infrastructure assets policy. And just before I ask you to speak, I'll just ask a comment from the administration on this item. Thank you.
Through the chair, as of depending on the questions, I mean, there's nothing of point to note in this particular report from our perspective, other than it is an update to the policies and procedures that we followed previously and was the request of motion on those previously.
Thank you. Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I have a question which may lead to an amendment. May I ask the question first? That's possible. Thank you. Broadly, it's great. It's an improvement on the previous policy, and it's great that there are a whole range of other things that now need to be taken into account when considering the disposal of assets. But I did notice, however, that at 4.7 on page 31 and at 6 on page 33, There's an introduction talking about the disposal of land through all of the usual open processes, including sale, public tender, expressions of interest. But then there's the what might seem somewhat less transparent process of negotiation mentioned. What does that mean?
Through the chair, the item that councillor you're referring to is actually in the existing policy, which is actually the one that has been rescinded and has been updated. The new policy actually relates now back to our procurement policy, so that any acquisitions or disposals have to be done in terms of our contracts and procurement policies.
Okay, I apologise if that's the case, but I thought I saw the word negotiation in the new policy.
I don't believe that that was. Negotiation for
land sales.
Disposal.
Land sales, yeah. Disposal.
That would have, negotiation in that instance would have to be on very unique circumstances. For example, if it was maybe an encroachment of land and that we were closing a road and selling a small portion to them. It wouldn't be negotiation in every instance, because the contracts and procurement policy actually asks for a very open and transparent process. So there would have to be very specific circumstances to even go down a negotiation route. And it could be for strategic development.
I just wonder why. I mean, we've made this great leap towards the much more transparent open arrangements, and negotiation still remains, but it is interesting that it is in the context of sale of land specifically, and I wonder whether it has a place. The second question, and I may move that as an amendment, the second question is, what happened to, there is a reference in there to a policy that's apparently replaced, and it's unclear to me who will actually approve which transactions in terms of the delegations of the CEO and the Lord Mayor, which are dealt with in the old policy at page 23, but it's not in here. Is it somewhere else?
Through the chair, delegations are not best placed in policy. They're actually best placed in the schedule of delegations that council endorses every year. And so that's where that specifically...
So it's moved off into there. Okay, I'm happy about that. Look, if I have a seconder, I would like to move that removal of the word negotiation. It's 4.7.
It's in the definition too.
Can we get some comments?
Well, there's no point in getting comment unless there's a seconder to the amendment. You could just lapse. Okay.
Second, Councillor Moran.
Sorry, it's in the operating guidelines.
Councillor Marcus Irving, the motion is retired with that amendment that's been seconded by Councillor Moran. Do you have administration comments on that? Or have you not finished, Councillor Marcus?
Well, if I have a seconder, I'll speak to it. And
yes, we have a seconder and Councillor.
Yeah, sure. Look, within the policy, the operating guidelines at 4.7, there is this reference to disposal of land with a series of open and transparent processes of the kind that are expected of local government, not only by our constituents, but also by, I would have thought, government and regulatory authorities. We have a responsibility to always conduct ourselves in a manner that people can see. And we have, in this one instance, allowed the possibility that the sale of land can occur through negotiation. Now, I would have thought it is still possible to conduct a discussion about the sale of property and protect it through some confidential process, but negotiation is, in my view, something quite different. Negotiation, a sale of a plot of land by negotiation, doesn't require any of the other processes that accompany, for example, the sale of land through expressions of interest, open market sale, tender and so forth. All of those things can be traced, can be shown to have followed particular courses. Negotiation is a matter of simply walking up to an individual, an organisation, and saying, this is a project that you might be interested in, or here is a piece of land that you would particularly like. It doesn't seem to be the kind of open, transparent process that policy as a whole endorses.
Come to the administration, please.
Through the chair, if I may. The disposal of land owned by council is actually quite a complex and already pre-step process. So if somebody approaches us and says, oh, I'm quite interested in that land, or if we say to anybody else, we might be quite interested in that land, we couldn't do anything unless we brought that opportunity that was being explored back to council. You have to go through council, you have to step through the process, you have to go to public consultation and go through two or three houses of the current parliament to dispose of council land or any community land. I think I don't understand the inference in terms of not having negotiation as an opportunity, simply because that discussion that takes place could be a negotiation, and surely you're not precluding that, you're just assuming that's part of the process of engaging with the public.
Councillor Malani.
Can I ask a question?
Oh, sorry, the seconder, Councillor Ray. Apologies, Councillor Ray.
We need to have some reactions.
Yeah, I don't think we're talking about community land.
No.
We're talking about Walter Street, yeah. Things like that.
Which is being auctioned tomorrow.
Which is being auctioned tomorrow. And we felt that wasn't open. I mean, it wasn't as open and transparent as I'd like. We're talking about you, the staff, the administration, going and negotiating to buy or sell land outside the normal way. We're not talking about negotiating to bring it to council or anything like that. So could you re-answer that question?
Through the chair, if I may. The whole process before Wall Street got to that stage was a process that came through a series of discussions with council, public consultation and two houses of parliament before we got the authority again from council to proceed with that sale. The method of sale after that point was again brought to council for your endorsement, even when we went to auction. So it came to council about three or four times.
Okay, well, that's a bad example, but why leave the word negotiate? I don't think the word negotiation to the casual reader means you negotiating with the guy to bring it to council. The word negotiation in that context means you negotiate a price and a sale. So would you not be, you'd be quite happy about that being left out then? Because it's not what you, what would you would do anyway.
Through the chair, I mean, we've got a very prescribed way that we go through the process, and it is process driven, and it is in front of council. So, in terms of, I'll seek advice from the technical experts as to what the legal definition of that would mean.
What would you lose? The question I want to know is what would change if you deleted negotiation?
Administration, please.
Through the chair. If we lost a negotiation, if that was a circumstance where, say, somebody had encroached on road and we had to close maybe a metre of road to sell to them to fix that encroachment, by losing negotiation, it also would mean that we would then have to offer that land up for open tender. Mm-hmm. So that's the scenario we would lose if we dropped the word negotiation out of that. Not that it has any relevance, but it is the same wording that the LGA have used also for the acquisition and disposal policies, that they suggest that there's a range of ways in which you can acquire and dispose, and they all have relevance based on the unique nature of the transaction that you're looking at. So where it's just a simple transaction, say for an encroachment, or it's something, for example, similar to the hospital, where you wouldn't have put that out to the open market because the sale of that road actually then led to the development. So that's the sort of circumstances you want to use negotiation.
Yeah.
But it's up to administration when they put the proposals up to council and suggest the proposed methodology. they have to actually justify the reasons for going down a particular route.
So we have to come and still to us.
Absolutely. Every land transaction actually has to be under common seal, and the only people who can affect the common seal is by council resolution.
Councillor Lardy.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I was going to ask Julia that question. I guess we've had a few examples of where we have needed the context of negotiation when there is actually, well, I think what you're saying, correct me if I'm wrong, there is actually only one possible partner or person to sell. Generally, it's very small strips of land that don't actually, that might be related to a development or something, where you actually, you can't take it to open market, it's not possible. There's literally only one possible. I guess that we're trying to get some assurance that that's the context that we're referring to in this policy, for which I'm very comfortable. And if we took it out, it would remove the ability to have those conversations with those potential partners. So I urge everyone to keep it in, because Councillor Moran, what I'm telling you is that there are certain circumstances where they're very small strips of land that relate to a particular development. For example, we had one on, I think, Weymouth Street recently, where there is only one potential partner or purchaser for that example. So that would preclude us if we took this out from having.
How do we limit it just to those, though?
So, well, maybe we could get some advice on, because we don't want to limit
it
ourselves.
It doesn't say that in there, does it? But it's just a small strip of land with only one buyer. So technically, future staff will take that.
I'll ask the question.
Basically, the administration's potential wording that could have
We can't preclude from having those conversations. Well, I'm asking a question, I guess.
Well, I can ask that of the CEO, who in previous role has assisted wording.
It comes to councils.
Yeah, through your chair, look, it's difficult for us to provide the correct wording at the moment. Suffice to say, though, that including the word negotiation in there and the fact that we need to refer every negotiation to council, if a negotiation was seen by you to be improper or inappropriate, you would simply not allow it.
Exactly.
So to me, from a CEO's point of view, I think that there is adequate protection for you as council without the word with the word negotiation being in there from a procedural point of view.
So given that, Chair, I'll either give the mover the opportunity to change his position, or I'll foreshadow it that goes back to as printed. I'll give them, if you want to give the mover that choice.
Are you asking me to sum up or agree?
No, I just asked whether you consider amending.
Well, I would consider amending it if we were talking about making it more specific in the terms that have been discussed. Part of the problem here is that on the basis of a very narrow range of transactions, we're including a word that would cover a broad range of transactions.
Is that a yes or no question, Chair? That's what I'm looking for.
You're trying to resolve this issue, so it's obviously amenable to an amendment.
Yes, I told you.
If the Chair's, after the conversation and advice that we've had, given that we have some level of comfort, majority, that would the Chair go back to as printed, or that's the question I'm asking you to ask the mover, or if he's saying no, I'll foreshadow that I'll move as printed.
But if this is tested by a vote, it just goes back to the original, doesn't it?
Yes, I do, because
it wasn't an amendment. You moved it from the floor. Does need to be foreshadowed.
You moved it so it's not an amendment.
Not an amendment.
I did foreshadow it as an amendment.
No, you
said
you moved it as the original.
No, I asked the question and said that I foreshadowed the amendment.
Members, if I can clarify for you, the matter before you is a motion that contains amended wording from Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Moran.
So I will then, given the mover doesn't want to go back, change his motion, I'll foreshadow as printed.
Okay. Councillor Hendon.
I don't need to speak now.
back to the mover, Councillor Martin, to summarise. Any further discussion?
Or are you sticking with it?
What are you asking me to change it to?
Just back to
as printed.
As printed.
Yes.
So you're asking me to withdraw the motion?
Yes. Seek leave to vary the motion back to the way it was printed, to how it was printed.
Look, I'd rather lose it. I mean, let me sum up and then we'll lose it. I mean, the point that I make is that the word negotiation applies to a broad range of transactions. I acknowledge that there are specific land disposal or acquisition proposals where this might be an entirely appropriate means of conducting the transaction. But including the word negotiation in the broad range, in the suite of methods for disposing of land without any specific wording invites not for this administration, but for administrations later on when this policy is still in force, to conduct a negotiation. And there have been occasions at council, I'm aware, of negotiations having been conducted and ultimately proposals being brought to council, but those negotiations have all been confidential in their nature, and I think had the potential to create the wrong impression. So I'm just saying an open process in which, if it is necessary to restrict the word negotiation to specific circumstances, fine. But to apply it to the broad range of transactions is, in my view, potentially dangerous. Now, I'd urge you to support that. If somebody wants to propose a slight change in the wording that would make sure that we captured all of those occasions where negotiation might be a reasonable thing, I'm prepared to accept that. But I'm not prepared to accept removing it completely. And I'm quite happy if everyone decides that they don't agree.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. I now put that to the vote. All those in favour?
A majority of one.
Those opposed?
No, sorry.
You're opposed? Oh, yeah. Yes. And the administration may have an opportunity to provide Councillor Martin's wording to
refine. I'll foreshadow that, Chair.
If you do it in council, though.
I'll foreshadow the
Yes, now I'll come back to Councillor Martin.
Yeah, I'll move as printed.
Seconded Councillor Hendon.
Just briefly, look, I understand context in which you are trying to bring transparency, but I think that we understand the context of this policy. So I think that negotiation in this policy position gives us the opportunity when those specific circumstances arise, and Julie's given an example where we need to have that in the policy. It always comes back to council. It's not a free rein we're giving here. It is part of a policy and local government association use this terminology as well. It is very niche circumstances that it applies to, and it always, always, always comes back to council for a decision. And I think that is that should give the reassurance that's needed. And policy should never have occasions where it may or may not exist. Policy is meant to give certainty. Policy is meant to set the way in which we make decisions. You can't have policy that says, oh, but it might be this, but it might not be that. That's not what policy is designed for. So I urge council to support this. And I'm sure administration have now taken on notice very much the desire of this council to demonstrate that we're showing good transparency.
Councillor Clary.
Look, I acknowledge Councillor Martin's concerns, and I thank him for raising the issue. But I believe there are sufficient checks and balances in existence for negotiation to be very carefully monitored and for no ill use of it to occur
I have confidence in the existing procedures for that to occur.
If I may just quickly speak as chair.
No, can I ask that the speaker can only speak with permission?
I seek leave to speak. Thank you.
Sorry, Sandy, that meeting procedure has to be stuck to it. And I checked with the secretary.
Okay, show of hands.
She told me we can't.
No, well, she told me you can't.
Seek leave to speak.
Can we have clarification?
Thank you.
Correct.
My experience is in commercial property negotiations, as distinct from how I often see it happen with council negotiations, is in commercial property negotiations, which I get involved with in my work, is that there are times when a particular party, the vendor or the purchaser, has particular leverage and uses that leverage to advantage their position. Such that if you have one prospective buyer, but they desperately need it, one is in a position to actually get a better price than one would otherwise negotiate. But in my experience, just a general rate is usually applied, and I've seldom, if ever, seen council actually negotiate using what leverage it may have in a particular situation, which I think is an opportunity which ought to be looked at, so that we are acting commercially in such instances. I'll put it back to the mover to sum up.
Summed up.
All those in favour? All those opposed? Carried. Thank you. Item 8, Chester Street Landscape Assets.
Yes, I reserve my right, Chair.
Is there
any did you move?
Am I moving it?
You called it out.
Well, I'm moving it then.
And I seconded it.
I reserve my right.
I didn't call it out.
No, that's fine. Just let it go. That's the one that's asked.
Any further discussion? I flagged that I'll speak to this at the council meeting when I have a
Can I say, I'll give you permission to speak if it avoids you having to pull something out at the council meeting and waste time in that process.
Permission, I'm going to vote against it.
I'll give you. Who gives permission, Sandy, to speak?
No.
Thank you.
Good.
As chair, I'm not in a position to move any amendments. So, being very familiar with Chester Street and having looked at the proposal, we seem to have a situation where we have a particular property owner who is not happy with what is being put upon them, which is the obligation for the maintenance of a structure over the public realm. And for that reason, they're wanting to remove this enhancement of the public realm. And I think that the proposals involving having freestanding structures that are not fixed to the building is a very expensive way of dealing with a situation that's basically been in place since 1975. And I think that there'd be far more cost-effective ways and your zigzag sort of new expensive ratepayer spend options for it. And I think there'd be a far more cost effective way of just maintaining the status quo and doing some in situ repairs or at a much lower key repair of basically what is a very, very successful and one of our greenest streets. And the vines that have died that are on private land could be replaced on public land, so if you did in a public realm. The upright posts that are proposed would make the footpaths unbelievably narrow for anyone on the ground or something like that. So I think there's a few issues there that need to be resolved. And I think it'd get a lot more cost effective thing. And even if I think it's quite reasonable for council to bear the cost
of the maintenance of this stuff, which is over the public realm, and if that gets the particular wider organisation sort of off the council's thing, because they're not wanting to bear some of that cost, then that would ultimately save ratepayers money and yet keep one of our nicest streets as it is. Thank you.
I just wanted to very briefly give a bit of background to, I've been sort of monitoring this for some time now. It all started when many of the businesses on Chester were in a desperate state of help when they, when one of the DAs that were approved when they did that piece of work, they accidentally, assuming, killed the one of the vines. And the businesses in that street have desperately were constantly ringing council because the vine was dying, it was dropping, it was falling. We're constantly down there trying to, the admin did a great job responding to their needs, trying to get rid of some of the dead vine. It's a tragedy that happened. But when we were standing there and we're looking at solutions on how to deal with this vine, and you know, it was became very apparent then that actually these beams, that the structures are in a dangerous, poor state. So an engineering report was called for. That's what this is about. So whilst I do agree with Councillor Wilkinson, there probably are more cost-effective ways to deal with it. Lighter, quicker, cheaper is our motto. I do hope that we can go in and negotiate and get some good outcome, and hopefully they'll come to the party. There is a lot of challenge around who owns the building and who sold the building at what time and who's responsible for all these things. It would be really nice, though, for the businesses on that street. It's a beautiful street. It's got so much potential. You know, in its heyday, it was great with Chester Cellars. And so we do need to look at what we can do for the tenants and the businesses and the business owners in that street. Lighter, quicker, cheaper would be a great way, and I hope we can get to that place. But those beams, something has to be done about them. They're going to cause some damage.
Yeah, look, I wasn't going to pull this out, but now that it's been pulled out, I totally endorse the comments of the chair. I have a real, I also really believe that there's an opportunity for us as a city to find simple ways, simple light touch ways of greening our city. And I'd like to see this Chester Street redevelopment, which has to be done as a result of the engineering problems that we've got. And we've got plenty of time to give it some thought. You'll note that paragraph 5 says that the administration is going to prepare a streetscape design for Chester Cellars Chester Street and the surrounding laneways under the Greener Streets program. So I don't think we need an amendment. They're going to come back to us with some design options. And paragraph 6 says they're going to bring those design options back to us. I think the point that we want to make, or certainly I want to make, and I think the chair wants to make, is that we included in those design options, we want a lighter, quicker, cheaper option. And I'd like to see it as a real pilot program for how we can do this, because one of the problems the city has is that we find it really difficult in some places to plant trees because of the underground. We are great at growing grapevines. We are a vine state. Bunging a grapevine in, putting a few wires up, and between existing buildings with the encouragement and the consent of the building owners themselves, and we've got ourselves a green street. A fabulous green street, and I don't want to see it. I would much prefer not to have an engineered solution. I'd like us to use existing buildings, the goodwill of the people in the area, some simple solutions, and to come back with something that is a quick, cost-effective, attractive way of greening that area that we can apply in other places. And I think this is a golden opportunity to do that. So I've just asked that the administration take on board that we would like to see that sort of option as one of the options that comes back to us, so that we can make that assessment against the other options. And there might be some more engineered options that need to be provided as well, but certainly we want one of them to be the quick and dirty.
Quick and clean.
Discussion.
I just wanted to make a comment. There's a lot of wine mentioned in this report. I think it's supposed to be vine. Interesting. the the slips here.
Report was written after lunch.
Instead of buying lots of wine. A few lunches have been had there, obviously.
I put that back to them. Councillor Martin. Summed up. I put that. All those in favour? All those opposed? Carried. Thank you. Item 9, park bans, leasing and licensing policy, Councillor Martin.
Chair, I'd like to propose a series of amendments, if I may.
I'd like to put a motion with amendments.
They don't have to be amendments. Can you adopt the wording right?
Amended.
Amended? Yes, I have to include the purpose. So, just to make it clear, I'm moving a motion that amends, is that correct?
Motion that needs amendments.
Okay. Would you like me to read each of those? No, I'm sorry, Chair. At the very last minute before the meeting, I remembered to do this, and so therefore it's on paper.
No, the feeling. Okay. Just allow that to be typed up so members can consider those amendments, please. Okay, well, perhaps if the mover could maybe read out those amendments.
Yes, certainly.
Whilst they're being typed.
Yep. From page 129, delete text for 6.1 and insert the premises must only be used for the purpose of the sporting club and change rooms of the lessee. And the premises must not be hired, sublet, or made available to any other person, and must not be used for functions other than those directly part of the sporting activities of the lessee without the consent of council. Page 87, delete 12.1 of the operating guidelines. Page 75, remove from 13.1 of the policy statements the words "or other competitive process." Page 89, add the words "and will be made available to interested parties" after the word "location" at 17.2 of the operating guidelines.
Through the chair, I just wonder whether these are, I mean, I absolutely get it, and I'm not wanting to criticise Councillor Martin, but these are quite detailed things, and I just wonder whether if there's a better way of doing it, whether we could take these on board and consider them at the council meeting where we've had an opportunity to read them in context, because really, without actually going through and putting them into the document themselves and seeing how the changes work, it's very hard for us to make a judgment of whether these are a good idea or a bad idea. They may well be great at I think we could have some administrative comment on how we might best get a good decision making process for this.
Well, I would prefer to have the discussion now, as is the right of committee, and if, as a consequence of this process, Councillor Hender is not happy, then you can either amend at council, or you can argue for if there was solicitation. I'm quite happy to take you through them.
Take us through it.
Please take us through it for the benefit
of the office. Am I going to
second it? I'm happy to second it.
Councillor Clare, second.
No, I've got a question. Hang on. Is this going to? This was presented in an email to at the members. And we left it on the table so that we could look, you know, so it could be incorporated, then we could look it up. Is that going to be dealt with in that for this Thursday?
Correct.
Through the chair, if I may. The nature of bringing this into committee was for all members to actually see the draft report as it's being written now, bearing in mind that it will go into APLA tomorrow. And then by the time it comes back to council, we're hoping to have picked up the discussion that's been held in committee and the discussion that's been held in APLA and be able to incorporate that into the report.
Just for Councillor Moran's information, I have actually argued prior to this meeting that this whole matter be deferred until after APLA. on the basis that this is putting the cart before the horse. However, the administration insisted on proceeding in this way.
Oh, I see. I think that's good. I
would have
thought it was better to
find
hear what
Adelaide
was saying.
I'm happy to.
I'll come to the administration.
Yeah, through the chair, if I may. This report has been trying to get to committee for consideration for quite some time and being deferred a number of times. And we've got a number of outstanding leases that need to be negotiated under the current policy and framework. And what we'd like to do is get an endorsed position from council in relation to the old framework versus the new framework as we're presenting it to be able to continue with those.
APRA's this Thursday. It can't get endorsed till next Tuesday anyway, and this council is supposed to operate only with APRA's advice. It can choose to. So I think this should lie on the table.
I agree.
Yeah, but with your permission, lie on the table till it gets APRA's advice and be debated in. I think that's the right way to do it, because we could shoot off. We've just seen, most of the councils have just seen it here. We've APRA members have seen it before. Where did you get it all? Anyway, it hasn't been put to a proper thing. So APRA's only 2 days' time. I think.
Are you saying they haven't seen this document?
No, they haven't seen.
They have, but
they haven't seen the amended document. This, the form of the document you have before you is updated on what we're talking about.
So this is different from the email that you sent to APRA members.
Yes.
But basically the gist of it's the same?
No, there are some fundamental alterations.
Okay, well it must go to APRA then first.
Yeah, through the chair, just to clarify, from a process point of view, you're absolutely correct. The matter should go before APRA, before it comes to committee. The reason is that there is some pressing leases and licences that are outstanding at the moment that we will need to progress under the existing agreement, and therefore we need to move this forward as quickly as possible. Notwithstanding that, it is feasible for you to let this matter lay on the table, for it to be discussed by APRA on Thursday night, and then it be referred to council on the 15th. If you're happy for the, directly to council, yeah, that may resolve your concerns. Mm. It would just mean that you need to debate it in for council. Yeah. If you're happy to do that, that would work quite well.
We're all happy.
Yeah, I'm happy.
I'm happy to withdraw my seconding.
I'm happy to read that.
I'll move
to take it directly to council with APRA's advice.
Without
recommendation. Happy to second. Well, hang on. Be careful about that, because what comes from APRA may be different.
We'll
await the council with any revisions from APRA.
Just my understanding is APRA will give a report that council will note. We will have a report on this matter. We can make amendments at that time during that report and go from there. Is that my understanding is correct?
Yes, through the chair. So the resolution of this committee would be that the matter be referred to APRA and to full council. I think that's correct. Can you just clarify that?
Members, the recommendation and determination of this committee would be that this matter be referred to council for consideration.
That's what I'll move, because the report will come in also from APRA at the same time.
Can I just ask, just a point of order, I'm a point of procedure. What is getting referred to APRA? Is it the original motion, or is it the motion that Councillor Martin moved?
No, it's the original.
Thank you.
It's the original report which would be presented to APRA and considered this Thursday. What would then be presented to council as a result of this resolution is the report that is before you with the advice of APRA.
Thank you. And I wonder whether, if it's still appropriate and relevant, Councillor Martin might circulate his amendments as well,
that.
So that we've got both those things in front of us at the council meeting.
And at that, you will raise the
debate. Yeah. So, did I get a second for that?
I don't think I need to.
I was taken up from Deputy Lord Mayor. Just quick on that.
I don't need to speak.
Any further discussion? Moved by Councillor Mullaney, Deputy Lord Mayor.
So, thumbed up?
No. I put that. Those in favour? As opposed? Carried. Thank you. Item 11, Councillor Hender, Wilcox, Fiddlester and Chatham Street's design options.
I've just got a question, so if somebody else would like to move it.
He's happy to move as printed.
Deputy Lord Mayor, so move as printed. Seconded by
It's actually a couple of questions. One relates to Claxton Street. So we've got it, we're lining up a bikeway, Wilcox, Fiddlester, Chatham, and we had at some stage also discussed either going to Claxton or the other one, Lowe. That's fallen off the radar, or where are we?
Tanya, do you want to respond to that through the chair?
Through the chair, no, what we've done is we've started the link from Wilcox, reviewing the work that was done previously in Fiddlester, because there was some greening requests from the residents, and then looking at Chatham. Once we do this consultation, the intent is that the next two streets we'll look at is Lowe and Claxton. So at the moment, there's some works happening under on Claxton Street under the residential street development program, where some slow points are being put in. So we'll be evaluating those and their impacts, and then but then we'll be looking at longer term solutions as part of that link.
So it's still in the mix.
Yes, definitely. And the link goes right up to Groat Street, and then moves up through Grey and Elizabeth up to North Terrace.
Okay. And then my other concern, I suppose, is the link at the other end, because at the moment these streets hit a T-junction at South Terrace, and there is no bike lane coming in. I know, again, that there's some discussion about a bike lane. I'm just wondering where we're at, if you can remind me.
Yep, through the chair. At the moment, we've actually developed some concept designs to continue the shared use paths from Ville Gardens right up to West Terrace. Where our plan is to try and put that up as a state black spot funded project for next financial year. So that's a project that we've developed concepts for, but we're just seeking funding opportunities.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion? Back to the moment.
Summed up.
I put that. All those in favour? All those opposed? Carry. Thank you. Item 15, other business. Any other business pertaining to infrastructure in public space? And there are no items for exclusion public, no confidential items, so I can now declare the meeting closed at 6:50.
Councillors, we're not going to start the next meeting for about 3 minutes, so if you want to take the opportunity to have a stop.
Why should we go ahead and say
It's freezing over here. Maybe I could change sides. Is it cold or hot?
Members, I need people to take their seats so they can recommence, please. Community Development Committee meeting of the 8th of December open. Members, we've already given the indication about the live streaming, so I'll move straight to the acknowledgement of country. The Economic and Community Development Committee acknowledges that we're meeting on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, the Adelaide Plains, and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs, and relationship with the land. We acknowledge they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today.
It's not their land, that's untrue. It's factually correct.
Thank you, Ms Henderson, for that valuable interjection. We have one apology, that's from the Right Honourable Lord Mayor, who is recognised in Paris. Can I have someone move the confirmation of the minutes, please? Moved by Councillor Corbell, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. Can I put those? That's carried. We have no public forum, we have no Chair's verbal report, so I can move to the adoption of items on block. I'll call them out, please give us a shout. Item 7. Item 8, I'm going to call out. Oh, sorry, Councillor Martin is going to call out. Item 9. Councillor Corbell?
Yes,
item 10.
Sorry,
Item 11, Main Streets, sorry, I should be reading out the items, I beg your pardon, Main Streets Development Programme, Councillor Martin. Item 12, out of session information papers to note. Oh, gosh, Councillor Clarahan.
Oh.
Oh, I'm sorry if I sounded reluctant, Councillor Clarahan. It's just the other chairs did so well.
Mine got pulled out.
So that's item 12, item 13, that's it.
Can I ask a question, procedure? Other business not be part of on-block call-out?
No. So you called out other business?
Are you doing the call-out?
Yes, but I haven't called other business. No, I haven't called other business. No, I called item 12, which is the information papers to note. I haven't called item 13 as other business.
You're in the wrong committee. They're looking at the wrong
papers.
Okay.
So, members, the only item that we are able to move on block is the mobile food vending program, item 7.
Okay. Has anyone called it?
I'll move.
No.
I called that up.
What?
No, you called out item 8, according to the Secretariat.
No, I called 7.
I didn't call out anyway. So what do we do in those circumstances if Councillor Martin wanted to... Oh, well, then it's my fault, then I'm willing to reopen that, Councillor Martin. Let's address it. My apologies if I missed you. So, Councillor Tobe, I've got nothing. Councillor Martin, item 7, mobile food vending program amendments to the operating guidelines.
Look, thank you, Chair. And look, I'll be honest, I've called it out simply to vote against it on the basis.
Can we get, before you start to speak, I think we need a mover and a seconder, and you're obviously not going to want to move it. So it's moved by Councillor Abiad, sorry, by the Acting Lord Mayor, and seconded by Councillor Malani.
Reserve their right.
Second
of
reserve
their
right. So over to you now,
Councillor
Martin.
Yes, thank you. Look, I just want to reiterate that this policy does not serve the intentions that it was intended for. The serial interventions haven't satisfied the bricks and mortar businesses. They have not satisfied the food van operators either. There were and are, until the end of this year, 36 licences. 16 of those general permits will not be renewed. And so there are 16 business owners who will lose their permits. So a friend of bricks and mortar and a friend of mobile food vans, I do not believe that this is yet the right policy. And in fact, Councillor Moran and I have for some time been arguing that a refinement along the lines of a location-based policy would better serve the interests of the city. That is, of course, academic now because the state government is going to intervene. It is doing so on the basis that our policy hasn't worked. Now, I'm not going to say anything further, and indeed, I'm so filled with goodwill at this Christmas period that I'm not even going to comment about the problems that we've had over the past few weeks, and I'm not even going to mention the F word.
Except you just did.
No, I'm being good. I'm filled with Christmas spirit. But I do want to make the point that it is not working and it is wrong to suggest that it can possibly work. And so if you would like now move that so that we can all vote. That'd be sensational.
Councillor O'Clohan, Councillor Martin,
Could I ask a question of administration in relation to the claim by Councillor Martin that there are going to be some existing licence holders who are going to miss out on? I thought that was all related to before 6 o'clock.
No. Some comment from administration.
Through the presiding member, we did provide some data to a council briefing earlier in the year, which talked to, I think it was around 17 of the existing permits only being used since April 2 to 5 times. So in terms of reapplication, we've seen quite strong numbers of people still applying to be part of the programme.
Did that answer your question, Councillor Cohen? Would you like a follow-up question?
So existing, there will be no existing licence holders who will be inconvenienced?
Through the chair, I don't think so.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Moran.
Yes, well, this has all been said, but before, I'm still not quite sure how many food vans are allowed at any one time, but I think it's basically irrelevant. I think there was a far better solution to this that would have kept the bricks and mortars and made it my job to go and speak to a lot of them, and they don't care how many. They'd rather none, of course, but as you know, as people do, but they don't really care how many there are as long as they're not near their bricks and mortar shop. And I suggested that what if we put them down at the riverbank or along North Terrace in the university bus with lawns? Fabulous, absolutely fabulous. There's nothing really to stop a popular spot being swamped with food vans in this new one as it was in the old one. We should have gone to a location-based food van, become a location-based food van city. Then we could have licensed a lot more. There are plenty of places. West Terrace, look, I'm no expert in where they are, but when I spoke to the bricks and mortar and the food truck people, they bundled over with locations that they would be happy to be in. It showed absolutely no interface and conflict with the two businesses. That is the answer. Lift the numbers of trying to work out with the wisdom of Solomon how many. Clearly, 20 you said, 10 the motion actually said, 30 the advertiser reports. Nobody's got any idea, and there will be food vans inconvenience because we are lowering the number. So I had asked you one last time to throw this out, set up a location-based system, which in speaking to the food vans and the bricks and mortar that I have spoken to, they much prefer. No, I think as Sam said last time, and I do agree, if everybody leaves a little unhappy, then it's not a bad solution. Everybody left a lot unhappy because nobody knew how many food vans there were. The bricks and mortar, they thought the motion and were correct that it was 10. The food van people thought there were 20. So now they're all a bit confused. So I think we have a better solution and we should let this one go. I mean, mind you, the power's been taken away and the state government may well bring that one in anyway. And I hope they do. But it's sad that we didn't come up with the good solution.
I agree with a lot of what Anne's saying about the locations and stuff like that. I think that would have been far more preferable for bricks and mortar traders. But my communication with business owners and stuff like that is you're worried about pulling the lid off the can and opening up a can of worms and having this all sort of redone and the state government getting involved and making it even worse. So they're far from happy with manifestly unfair situation that is now. I've vented my fury over this many a time, albeit a futile endeavour. They're all pretty pissed off with it. But they basically just take the attitude, well, just hang on to whatever we've got now. We don't want to reopen the thing unless it gets even worse. You know, so it's manifestly fair, but if it goes away to the state, the government just completely taking the lid off it, even worse also, they're reluctantly sort of grabbing the devil they know.
I've got another question. Will this all be reviewed in 6 months' time, pending the outcome of the government review?
As you know, with any council endorsed policy, administration constantly monitors that the effect and council's intent in developing that policy is met. So administration will review this, and if we see any concern or any indication that the policy is not meeting council's intent, then we would bring that back to you for you to review.
Just very briefly, I don't want to go down this pathway again, but to me, good policy gives certainty. This does that. It's cleared up some of the ambiguity that we had before. Good policy is agile, as Councillor Clarion says. We can change as we need to. I welcome the state government's consultation, because let them go through the same questions and challenges that we have. This is not a unique problem for Adelaide. Every other city in Australia has had these debates and challenges and this and that, and it's always going to be tinkered with. What is critical to this, and I could get admin comment if they felt they could add some extra value, but is the system that operates underneath this policy that is critical to supporting both bricks and mortar and mobile food vendors. And maybe, you know, we've been probing questions on that, and I have some level of comfort from admin that system is operating underneath this policy well. There's good resource, there's good dialogue going on. The bricks and mortar are happy. They do like the restriction, and it will be very interesting to see the wider consultation. I'm actually very interested myself to see what a wider range of stakeholders in different areas across the state think. So certainty, yes. Agility, yes. We can bring it back, we can tweak it. That is the beauty of the system that we operate in. So let's give certainty now. We've got clarity. Let's put it out there. Let's give the operators the chance now to get their permit applications in. There is no one is, according to the staff, missing out. So let's just get on with it.
Administration, Councillor Maloney suggested you might want to add something to that. If you do, there's your opportunity. Not requesting. Please go ahead. Anything to add? No? Okay. Acting Lord Mayor.
Look, I'll take this opportunity to sum up and look, thank you all for your patience in trying to address and deal with this issue. As it was mentioned before, this is a global phenomena. This is not something that is just specific to Adelaide. And one of the things that we really need to focus on here, and the reason to why I brought this about to some degree, is really about creating a microeconomic system around the food trucks. This is an incubator program, and we need to look at it as an incubator program. We're talking about $600,000 worth of money that this sector generates in the city of Adelaide. It's very minute. However, it's constantly under attack. What we're able to do with this program, if we're creating an incubator around it, a microeconomic incubator around that program, we can ensure the success of this program. We can grow it as we need to grow it every single year. And there is certainty for them. There is also an element of competitiveness amongst them, where they're not feeling that there is going to be 50 or 60 trucks at any which time to compete with a very small market of $600,000 a year worth of annual revenue. This is just as good for food trucks that it is going to be for brick and mortar businesses. It's going to give also the brick and mortar businesses certainty that there is 20, and that will grow as it needs to grow and as can be reviewed by council. That certainty is clear. They know to expect that every year there will be some changes as required, if there is any required. But most importantly, just like we do have underperformance in brick and mortar businesses in hospitality, and I've been in hospitality 10 years of my life, we will have the same issue with some of the mobile food vendors. We're out of the permits that people are using. We've heard that only
some of the permits are only used twice or three times for the full year. I mean, that's, if you're not involved in the program, if you're not part of the program, then maybe you shouldn't have a permit. And that will be an opportunity for the entrepreneurs in brick and mortar to contribute, to be part of that ecosystem and grow. I've had things over the last 6 weeks, I've been debating this, where people have said, why is it just mobile food vendors? Potentially council could look at that, where it's mobile vending, not just mobile food vendors. It could be a host of, it could be anything that we could do. We're not against entrepreneurial activity. We're not against innovation. We want to have a free market where government's not interfering. And I've been pinned in the last couple of weeks around, why would you support Uber versus not supporting mobile food vans? And it's very simple. What has happened in the last two decades or three decades with governments is governments have tightened their grip on everything to do with business. In the case of Uber, if the government was to release the pressure off the taxi industry, competitiveness created. When we're talking about free enterprise, it's not the role of government to give a leg up for one community over another, unless it's an incubator-based program. When we're talking about incubators and startups, we need to fund them, we need to innovate with them, we need to support them as much as we can until they step out of an incubator-based program. This is why this program will be protected as an incubator, because there's two things that have happened now. We've limited the amount of permits, but what we've also done is we've pushed back the public debate. We have pushed back. Not one brick and mortar business has called me up and complained about this. We have stopped that harassment and debate towards that sector. They will no longer be under attack. Mobile food vendors can strive, they can do their best. This program is the best iteration we've ever had to date. There is no zones. You can have six in the square. It is so flexible. After 6 o'clock at night, you can have as many as you want. In events, we can have as many as we want. This will give them the agility, and I'm certain, look, this is challenging, but like anything that's disruptive, it's hard to sort of take it on board and work with it. But now it gives us that clarity, and like I said, if we end up expanding the program to do other things, that's great, and we will have an opportunity to talk about the state government positioning and also the response to the consultation for food trucks in SA at item 8, so I'll conclude it here. And I'll thank you all for the patience and also the vigorous debate we've had over the last few weeks. It's been well worthwhile.
Thank you, members. Can I put item 7? All those in favour? All those against? Moving now to item 8. Just before I call for a mover for item 8, if I could just draw your attention to the motion itself. Members, if I could just draw your attention to the motion itself. At paragraph 3, it authorises the Chief Executive Officer to finalise the submission. I'm speaking, Councillor Mullane. Perhaps you'd just like to finish for a moment. There is an opportunity for us. This is the first time we've seen this submission. This is a submission that we are sending off to the state government. Paragraph 3 allows us, I think, to have some say here and have some discussion in this room today, and for our administration to take that on board to incorporate our comments into the paper that the discussion, not the discussion paper, into our response to the state government's discussion paper, and have it ready for us on the 15th, that is at council in a week's time. So that's what I'm hoping we might do today. If anyone's got any comments that they think might strengthen this submission or have some impact on this submission, then now's the time to make them, and our administration can take them on board. But first of all, what I need is a mover and a seconder, and then we can have that discussion and ask our administration to take it on board. So, moved by Councillor Carahan, seconded by the Acting Lord Mayor. Councillor Carahan, do you wish to speak?
No, I don't really.
Reserve your run.
Yeah. So I think we'll have an opportunity to discuss this. Is that the plan? Yep.
So, Councillor Wilkinson.
I need to move this as an amendment.
That was my point, Councillor Wilkinson. We don't need to amend this. We really need to give our administration some feedback that they can incorporate into our submission to the state government and have it ready for us on the 15th. And then if you don't like it on the 15th, move your amendment then.
Okay. Well, then I'd just like to put in that our submission to the state government ought to include some comparison of the relative cost of operation of comparable lunch businesses with food trucks. I'm not talking about restaurants selling licensed wine and stuff like that. I'm talking about little lunch sandwich shops. And so that when the government is considering their policy on this, that they are mindful of the fact that the little Vietnamese place on the corner of Flinders Street and Pulteney Street is paying $27,000 for their two-seat lunch eatery when they're sitting. And I think if our submission to the government, you know, if there's nothing that I could see in submission about that, but if it just provides some examples of those sort of figures that, because those people might have six food vans outside their, or 51 metres away from their business, paying $2,500 versus the 27, that's the lowest end of the spectrum for a little Vietnamese lunch shop there, food example. And I think that would assist the state government in their deliberations. Obviously, the food trucks might only operate on a Friday lunchtime, whereas they're operating 5 days a week, but I think that would be of assistance.
Thanks, Councillor Wilkerson. That's been noted. Acting Lord Mayor.
Look, I've got a couple of comments that I'll just make briefly. I welcome this. I'm not actually against this. I think this will actually uniform the process across the whole state and will give a focus and also the ability for some of the trucks that we've got to mobilise in different areas for different reasons. So I'm not against that. That's cutting back the red tape. I think we're going to be a little bit better, I guess, with the state government on how we deal with these issues. I think we should share all the information that we have, all the research that we've done. After all, we have started this program. We have made this program successful. We have made this program part of our city, and it's made our city vibrant, and we need to share all that information, our lessons, our findings, our failures, our successes, and some of the challenges that we've had in all different iterations of the program. I think that needs to be shared, and we need to be transparent in that. I know they're not as good as sharing information, but we are. So we'll put that through to them. The other things also to be able to take into account is one of the points was what Councillor Wilkinson has said. And there was one more point that, look, escapes my mind this second, so I might get back to it. But really it's about being able to share all the information with them so they can make they can take that into account and see the different iterations of how that's worked to date.
Okay, so all that's noted as well. Anyone else wish to make any comments? Councillor Martin and then Councillor Corbell.
Thank you. Look, I note from the administration's briefing that there are in the state government discussion paper just two options, and both would limit the council's power to control and effectively balance the competing interests to which public roads are put. Both would diminish local autonomy and limit self-determination by local communities in respect of the use of public assets owned by council. In other words, it's gone. Now, it is a bit macabre. It's a bit like somebody who's just been committed to the capital crime having a conversation with a hangman about the thickness of the rope to be used in the execution. But I think that we need to be directing our attention to the likely consequences of this, and they are that the council will be left with the administration costs of the food ban program in the city of Adelaide, while the legislative framework for it will be determined by government. And so it would be, in my view, rather than addressing the possibility that we can somehow hang on to this business, it would be, in my view, far preferable to deal with the actual consequences that would flow from the government decision to take control of it and how we would deal with the likely costs.
Okay, that's been noted. Councillor Corbett.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I too welcome the state government consultation on this. I recognise that because this is not an issue isolated. Mobile food vendors are not isolated to the city. Mobile food vendors are being used in other parts around the city and across the state, and it, certainly in other cities around Australia. So it seems as though there's a lot of sensibility to have some consistency in policy application and for feedback to be able to be provided to the state government.
we have 4 years worth of learnings, 4 years of research, 4 years of experience in developing our mobile food vending policy. And we have all of this information, and I think it's really, really excellent of the administration that we are willing to share this information. If, for example, $600,000 annually for a mobile food vending in the city doesn't seem like a lot of money, and I dare say that it would be similar amounts except lesser values in other parts of Adelaide. So for the state government to have a central authority, it seems to me a large dedication of resource for a very small portion of a micro economy. And I think that this, I agree with the administration that this should remain a local government issue, but that the councils, there can be inter-council collaboration and sharing of information. I just want to acknowledge the desire of the council to share the research that we have already and our learnings on the economic and social benefits.
Thanks, Councillor Caldwell. Look, I need to, given the time, to seek an adjournment or to get someone to move an adjournment so that we can open the next meeting. So could someone move by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Moran. All those in favour of adjournment, that's carried. I declare the meeting adjourned and hand over to Councillor to Acting Lord Mayor.
I declare the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting for 8th of December 2015 open at 7:24. PM, and I seek an adjournment. For someone to move adjournment, moved by Councillor Slana, seconded by Councillor Caldwell. Any debate? All those in favour? All those against? Meetings is adjourned.
Thank you, Acting Lord Mayor. I declare the Economic and Community Development Committee reopened. And Councillor Malani, I think you wish to speak to this item to add your comments.
Thank you. I'd like to see included. I think it's really important to tell the story of the evolution of this program. There's a very distinct story to where we started from as a trial and a pilot through in 2011, right through to the to very clearly define the iterations and why we had to make those iterations. I'd like to see, the second thing I'd like to see is the trends that we've seen. We know how many mobile phone operators operate when and how many, and I think it's very important we share that data and those trends. I'd like to see us share some of the feedback we've got by breakdown of stakeholder in those different categories. We know you've got the mobile food van, the trader themselves, you've got the people that use them, you've got the bricks and mortar, you've got some other stakeholders that are very like clearly like to see them broken down by stakeholder so you can cross-reference where the gaps are. I'd also like us to demonstrate why there's an argument while Capital City may have a different allowance of permits versus a metropolitan area. We are a capital city and we might actually have a different system as to how a metropolitan might run. And we have a vibrant city agenda. And I'd also like us to see the government identify how they can assist the innovation and entrepreneurs through funding, because that's where maybe there's something they can add value to that we can't, whether it's grants or some kind of initiative. So they're the things that come to mind for me.
Thanks, Councillor Lani. Before I hand back to the do you wish to speak to other than to sum up, Councillor Cohen?
No. Well, I will sum up. Yeah.
Okay. So just before we do that, I wonder whether I can seek the leave of the meeting to add a few comments for myself.
No.
So leave thought. Yeah. Thank you. I just wanted to add a couple of comments about also strengthening our submission in relation to the genesis of this program, and when we invented food trucks for Adelaide, I'd really like the state government to know that and for us to remind them of that. And some case studies or strengthen the story about some of the business that have gone on to now either, you know, open shops on Undy Road, now selling meatballs in supermarkets, you know, some of our good news stories. These are things that we incubated in our city, using our program, which has had some very significant successes, and I'd just really like the state government to be conscious of that. before they start dealing with it. So if I can move back to Councillor Carahan, unless anybody else wishes to make some comments for summing up.
Thank you. Look, there's a good story definitely to be told in relation to our mobile food vans around the city. We have supported them over the years. We have invited them to set up business, and they've been a great success. They've added to the interest in the city. There's that sort of unexpected element that people just love. I'm avoiding the word starting with V. They've been an absolute success. It's interesting that I was in southwestern New South Wales 2 weeks ago, and blow me down, there was one of our food trucks. So those food trucks are on the move. We've provided an environment in which they can safely establish themselves, test the market, and we give them wings to fly. Now, I don't think anyone can understate the support that has been offered by this city. And also, I don't think anyone can underestimate the way in which they've been embraced by the community. I remember the excitement back in 1979 when the first mobile food vendor set up in a garage up on McGill Road. Apart from the pie cart, we've not had any other mobile food vans. And my goodness me, the restaurants did feel that sort of exodus up onto McGill Road. And it was a novelty thing. The food was fantastic. It was new, great quality, blah, blah. Look, it's going to continue to happen. Pop-ups are a fact of life. And it's not just going to be around food. It's going to be pop-up everything, because that is the way our society is moving. So
our bricks and mortar.
Our bricks and mortar people need to adjust their business plans. You know, when you see places that have not changed their formula in the last 20 to 30 years, and then they turn around and complain about the impact of mobile food vans, you've got to ask the question, really, are they keeping up with the demand and customer expectation? And I'd have to say I'm very doubtful of that. So this is obviously, there's been some mixed messages going about council's approach to mobile food vans. I think a lot of the story has been skewed. I think we're in there supporting them and will continue to do so. The state government is welcome to review it, because they're dealing with food vans that are travelling across the state. I don't know how they're going to quite deal with those that go interstate, but anyway, I think what will happen is that there'll be further endorsement of the value of food vans, and I welcome that.
So can I thank all the members for their contribution. I think that really is going to enrich our submission to the state government. And can I put the motion?
Thank you.
All those in favour?
Thank you.
That which brings us on to item 9, Councillor Corbell, events in the parklands, Tasting Australia, Town Square and Hudson Circus.
Thank you, Chair. Actually, somebody will need to
move. I'll move it.
Moved by Councillor Mullany, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. To Councillor Mullany?
I'm going to reserve my right.
Councillor Wilkinson?
Thank you. I seek to have this with the in taken in part, so that's voted 1 and 2 separately.
Mover happy with that?
Yes.
Okay, so we'd like to take them apart. Does anybody else wish to speak to this item? Do you wish to speak to a councillor?
Oh, just that I'm not in support of the circus coming to town. We've debated this extensively earlier this year. And we all know the arguments as to why the use of exotic animals in the circus. So I don't support that, but I do, number one.
Okay, I'm going to sum up. I just recall Councillor Mann saying that she saw 50 dancing dogs in tutus and they're having a great time, poodles. So I just wanted to summed up.
So can I put it in two parts? So item 1,
which relates to Tasting Australia. All those in favour? That's carried. And paragraph 2, which relates to Hudson Circus, all those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Okay, moving now to item 10, which was called out by the Acting Lord Mayor, the report on the economic and social impact of the East End of moving the Royal Adelaide Hospital.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm happy to move and I seek a seconder.
Seconded by Councillor Maloney.
Look, I just wanted to briefly speak to this. This has been almost 4 years in the making. I wanted to take the opportunity to thank the administration for being able to put this information so quickly together. Just to remind some of the members, when I first got elected on council, this is one of the main issues that I was driving as part of being in the East End. And one of the things that comes to mind is understanding the economic impact of that of the hospital shifting. And when we were having a debate around that, one of the things that became very clear when we put a question out to the government, what is the plan for the state government in relation to the hospital? And that made the media at the time. It was very surprising for us that the government has had plans to build a hospital, but they did not have any plans for a vacant site and what they'll do with it. And that comes as a surprise to me when I look at how the state government is very proactive on food trucks, for them to not have had a plan for what they will do on a vacant site when they are shifting a hospital and the impact that would have on many people, retailers, residents and visitors at the East End. So we've requested to have an economic impact report done, economic and social impact report, to which took over probably the closest part of 2.5 years to get to achieve. We've asked the state government repeatedly for them to release that information so it doesn't cost our ratepayers any money. We have not been able to get any of that information from the state government, and that's why we've pushed to be able to get this. I am very optimistic about the future. I think it's exciting to be able to see that over the last couple of years, despite some of the horrible news that have been going around in the East End, the impact that will have, I think the East End has regenerated. It's set itself as a destination, and I truly think it will be able to sustain the transition period of which the hospital is being re-looked at, tendered, built, and whilst that transition is occurring and moving in 2016. With that, I think it's exciting for our ratepayers to be able to know very clearly what that impact in definition looks like. And it's looking like the 10 to 12% mark. It's describing it at a $14 million impact. Yes, it will have an impact. And by being able to define the impact and have a clearer understanding of what we can do to support it, I would look forward to, in the next couple of months, to work with administration for us to come up with a program on how we were able to support and transition the East End in that period when the hospital workers are shifting from the North Terrace site to the western side of the city. I think this is our role as a council, to be able to work and advocate also for the state government to help us in that specific cause. But also one of the other things I want to bring a note, I would hope that we could communicate with the state government that not to build the hospital and also an Oban project potentially if that does go through at the same time. I think the impact that would have on the East End will to some degree double, will turn into a construction site on both sides of it. So I think easing into that is going to be quite crucial. But look, the impact report, I'd urge every member to go through it in detail. It's very clear, very it's to the point. We're talking thousands of people every day that are going to disappear from the East End. I know as a hospitality business owner, and I know Councillor Slam has spent over 10 years in that area, I will tell you, when we heard the news, the first thing I did was ask my staff over 4 weeks to start capturing information of how many people come from the hospital. More than 30% of our business in the morning specifically was from hospital. So this is a dramatic hit to a small business in that area. As we've seen from the report, the majority of people that are employed in the East End are hospitality workers. That will have an impact on that sector. And it's our job as a council, and also I'm hoping as a state government, to mitigate those impacts and try to assist the community and to minimise those impacts as much as possible. So look, great work. Thank you very much. And hopefully the next time we're able to look at this, the next few weeks were able to produce some solutions on how we could possibly unlock some of the potential we have to assist the East End in this transition.
Thank you. Councillor Mullany? Any Councillor Martin?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Look, I too share the disappointment of the Deputy Lord Mayor that the government is not engaged in any way about the way in which this issue will be progressed. But my comment is specifically about the background details and at 31. And I just wanted to note that while the paper proposes potential future land uses, and the administration notes that we previously endorsed for the Royal Adelaide site offices, fashion shops, markets, etc. That is not the view of this council. This council has not taken a view on that. In fact, it hasn't even discussed it. And therefore, it is inappropriate to be sending that message to the government at this time. Indeed, all of the discussion at council since the last election has been about the difficulty associated with the development of private enterprises on parklands and particularly residential development. And indeed, you would be aware that the Lord Mayor particularly has expressed his concern that developments like offices, fashion shops and so on, markets, restaurants and cafes would present particular legal challenges related to the manner in which leases would have to be constructed over parklands. And I remind you also that it is part of the legislation, the amendments that were passed in 2005, that require redundant parkland, as that site will become after the Royal Adelaide vacates that space, requires repatriation to parkland. So it is a debate that is full of controversy, which has never really been canvassed here in the council that was elected in 2014.
And to my knowledge, nor in the council prior to that, certainly no endorsement of shops, fashion, those sorts of things. And so I think your point is well made, Councillor Martin, and I wonder if the administration is providing their report to others, whether they can just make the point that at no stage have we, as a council, endorsed those things, just to make sure that misconception is not spread as it reports.
Through the chair, yes, absolutely, we can take that on notice.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson.
I remember when we were discussing this issue before, and I had expressed my view that a private health facility within existing hospital buildings using some of the state-of-the-art facilities that cost millions, you know, would have been a great opportunity that would have provided a lot of the re-employment in the area. But because of all of the sort of pontification that's happened, in the meantime, you know, the most likely candidate to take up that opportunity is Calvary Hospital, who have now secured approval for a new building on the corner of Angus Street and Pulteney Street. It's a massive building, it's completely out of scale with its context, all that's allowable by the development plan set by the minister. But, you know, that's now happening there, whereas they would have been the best candidate as a private health to go into this, and that would have been a great solution, this site, which could have gone with other uses. But because of the lack of direction, you know, through the process, they've probably given up waiting and have made their own move, which means they're now out of the running. And I don't know if there's not another private health thing that we might achieve that we might take an opportunity. So that's part of the problem, that you know, the lack of action on this, you know, that opportunity now has passed through.
Councillor Mullany, I think you reserved your right.
I'm good.
Acting Lord Mayor, do you wish to sum up?
Yeah, look, just summed up.
Then I'll put that. All those in favour? All those against?
They're not voting.
Moving now to item 11, Main Street Development Programme. Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Look, it is just an update, and I will be moving. I will be moving it as printed.
Okay, so let me just get that down. You're moved and seconded by the Acting Lord Mayor. Carry on.
Thank you. And I have a couple of questions. What I read here is that there are problems with the implementation of the program to the extent that there are emerging tensions between people associated with the precinct group structure and those who are not members of that precinct group structure, as well as problems associated with demands on time, but such that there is a considerable staff resource required and an additional budget allocation is forecast in 16-17. And so therefore, I wondered, are we on the right track here? Is this the right way to go? Because it seems more and more time, more and more money is going in there, and there is still yet a measurable or an unmeasurable result.
Through the chair, so your reading, Councillor, is absolutely right that in embarking on a new direction and implementing a new approach, we have found the implementation more resource intensive than we had anticipated, and that it has taken longer to actually achieve an outcome than we thought. And that is because it is a change, and we've had to do a lot of work with people on the ground to help them progress that change. But they are actually really keen to see it progressed. And those people we're working with both in Hutt Street and O'Connell Street are very supportive of the process. And so the paper and the update tonight is to help councillors understand some of those challenges we've experienced en route. But we do believe that we will learn from the initial period of implementation, and that over time we'll get quicker. We're not necessarily foreshadowing a budget allocation. That would be a decision for council. But we're bringing this update tonight so that you can see what we've been experiencing. And if council were to want to accelerate the approach across different precincts, then that we're just flagging that would require further funding.
And another question. I notice also at 9.2.3 on page 147 that we anticipate broadening the business involvement to include residents. Now, we have elaborate structures here in council where we have a business precinct forum series of meetings. We have resident forum meetings, as we had last night. Is this foreshadowing that we're somehow merging them all together, or is this just a... I'm asking because it's foreshadowed at 9.2.3 on page 147.
Let me get an answer for you, Councillor Martin.
So, through the chair, apologies, Councillor Martin, I can't see you. I hope you don't feel I'm not making eye contact.
That's all right.
At the moment, we have a mixed economy across the precinct groups that are in the programme. Some of them don't have any resident representation, and some of them very much do. And we've been asked the question by groups, is it okay if residents in an area want to contribute to this process and feel that they might have time, a resource, a skill, or something to bring to bear in support of their local area, can they work with them? And we've of course said yes, we welcome all comers who want to contribute to these outcomes. So it's really helping clarify that. It's no intention to merge any of the existing ways, or in fact affect any of the existing ways in which members work with their residents.
So we leave all the structures in place. Okay, fine, that answers my question. Thank you.
Acting Lord Mayor, seconder.
Is that all right?
Anyone else wish to speak to this?
I just want to ask a question.
Yeah. Have we picked up any learnings from the work that's been done in relation to placemaking, and in particular the Melbourne Street experience? I unfortunately was unable to attend that workshop, and I've not had any feedback to date on with how successful it was. But any learnings from that exercise?
Through the chair, that's a very good question, and something we have thought about, and we have also discussed at ERG level. The key learning has been that in the case of Melbourne Street, there was a dedicated resource, as we know, in the placemaking pilot, and that did actually build some traction amongst the businesses in Melbourne Street, and we did see outcomes on on the ground as a result of that. But the key insight there was that dedicated resource and that consistency and that single point of contact for all the businesses in that area back into council. And that's one of the insights that's fed into the feedback included here about the need for resources. And it may be that when administration bring a report back for consideration of the next areas, that it's the learnings and insights from placemaking, and particularly some of the work that's underway in Melbourne Street, that you might want to consider in identifying the next areas for the program.
And just a follow-up question. So not only the resource associated with our placemaking, but also, what was the name of that? David Enright, was it? Someone? Sorry, what was
Enrich.
It?
Enrich.
Enrich, was it? Enrich.
Yeah,
him.
Were there any learnings from his participation with stakeholders in the street in terms of a slightly different approach, I suppose?
Look, through the chair, what I would suggest, given how recently that's occurred, we had intended to actually provide an update to council in regards to the outcomes from the Melbourne Street experience and provide some information from those learnings. So we'll do that.
Councillor Wilkinson?
Question, I mean, this is all about Main Street. Question to administration, how is the council's historic facade improvement scheme being incorporated and encouraged and promoted through this program, or is that not being mentioned to trades?
Through the chair, so Councillor, we have advised all of the precinct groups themselves of the scheme, and we've done that primarily through the Lord Mayor's precinct group forum, which I know you've attended. And we have also, over this last 12 months, and particularly as part of the Main Street Development Program, we've had more focus on the range of other grants and sponsorships that Council provides. And through Ivana Patterson from City Growth, we've actually been helping them access those additional resources.
Okay, anyone else wish to speak to this before I hand back to Councillor Martin to sum up? No? Councillor Martin?
Summed up.
Can I put that? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Which brings us to item 12, which was called up by Councillor Curran. Out of session information papers to note.
And I'm happy to move. Item 12,
moved by Councillor Graham,
seconded
by Councillor
Martin. And I've just got some questions. I noted in the research and discussion paper that administration had held a series of discussions with key stakeholders to sort of get early input into the project. And there was no one there from the North Adelaide community. Can somebody please tell me why, given that they are totally surrounded by parklands?
Through the chair, we went for a broad cross-section. So rather than invite every single group to the workshop, we just went for a representative sample. What I'm committed to doing is following up with that group separately, sitting down and having a one-on-one discussion with them to make sure that their concerns are fed in.
I asked that question because, one, they were very conspicuously absent, no representation at all from North Adelaide. Given that, you know, I'm the one that cops a lot of comments after weekends when we've got really loud music events on in the parklands, and I'm sure other North Adelaide people get it as well, it's quite demoralising. And I think I also mentioned that, you know, after we had the stereo sound all day Saturday, we then had another electronic concert all day Sunday, and even Sunday night, you know, I was cranking up the volume and I couldn't get rid of the noise, you know, and that was probably at 9:30 at night. So I think there are some major concerns. I acknowledge that this is a really good paper. It's very thorough. and comprehensive. My concern is that if we don't involve some key stakeholders at the beginning, we're going to end up with them being very antsy. And I note, for example, you know, that there were comments by some of the people at this meeting about those noisy, that noisy minority that always comment on events in the parklands. And I'm thinking, who are they talking about? You know, are those noisy minority all the residents in the city or around the edges of the parkland? I don't know. But I just felt that it was important that you get everyone on board at the initial stages rather than wait for them to become very antsy about the project. I also wanted to say that I noticed the change in wording. We've gone from respect the needs of the community and ensure they're not unduly affected by events to support respectful coexistence between events and their surrounding environment, aiming for cooperative business and social opportunities to maximise benefits for all in the local area. And I'm just wondering, you know, if I'm that cynic that says we've been left out of the discussion, you know, have the needs of residents in, for example, in North Adelaide that are adjacent to Elder Park and Benighton Park, you know, are they being written out of the equation? And I've been reassured that no, they haven't. But again, when you don't involve people at the early stage, I think, you know, we're at risk there of being seen to allowing concern to run wild, and then, you know, people are very cynical about the exercise. I think the fine tuning of the policy is fantastic in terms of identifying, you know, where we have our major events, where we have our medium-sized events, which areas are suitable for smaller events, even the desire to increase the level of events in the parklands, I think it's fantastic. And to actually identify specific uses for specific places so that we do manage those areas, including, you know, allowing those areas to recover. But I think what I'd also like to see is something about letting residents recover as well. You know, I don't think it's appropriate that they get slammed with two very loud events in 2 days. You know, with 2 days, I think we need to rest some of the people as well as some of the places, and I think that would produce a better outcome. And I do acknowledge that the report does refer to that, that it actually looks at how we spread large events that do have high impact around the city, and that is really positive. And again, that was why we set up the infrastructure in Park 24. But isn't it interesting that the majority of our large events seem to happen in areas that are very highly manicured and attended? So that seems to be the sort of space that attracts the largest number of people. So do we bite the bullet and say basically we need to set up some more areas around the parkland that are more tended, resource, they'll be more resource intensive, but they seem to be the sorts of spaces that people are really attracted to? So anyway, that was just a question. So thank you. A great report.
Councillor Maloney?
Yeah, I am aware we're just talking about a brief session of papers tonight, but I had a question on Tindo one, actually. I sent an email. I'm not sure I got a response. Can I just get some clarity? Is it true, is it correct, that the lease, the agreement with the provider in regard to Tindo, that if we ever want to use Tindo, we now need to pay for Tindo to be used.
Because the appropriate person here to give the answer.
We asked that question. You've already asked
that. No, I didn't get an answer.
But yeah, you did.
Well, I didn't.
You have to give them a certain time.
So through the chair, David's just exited the room, but my understanding is that yes, we need to pay for the driver aspects, and it's at a set fee, and that is the cost that we incur if we use Tindo.
That's only labour.
Well, it's very, I can tell you, it's very high labour cost. If we ever want to use Tindo, it costs us quite a bit of money. Well, that maybe you can take that offline, but it's not cheap.
Okay, anyone else wish to speak to these out-of-session information papers, or can we put them?
And we're not even allowed to use our own.
Can we put them?
Yes.
All those in favour? All those against? They are carried. Members, that brings us to item 13, any other business? Does anyone have any other business? If not, then I declare the meeting closed.
Okay, now we have a chance. Going for the record, boy. Come on. Get some brownie points for the other faction.
She's not used to the word.
That's not the word I was thinking of.
Members, I declare the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting open. 7:57 p.m. And I'd like to acknowledge that we are meeting on a traditional country.
Just ask
questions.
Yeah, do that.
Members, if I could have your attention, please. Thank you. The Finance and Business Services Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise. Maybe this is not your home, Kelly. This is their home. And pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs, and relationship with the land. We acknowledge they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Apologies, we have the Right Honourable the Lord Mayor Martin Hasey. Confirmation of minutes, can I have someone move, please? Thank you, Councillor Milani, seconded by Councillor Moran. Any debate? All those in favour? All those against? Those minutes are now confirmed. We don't have a public forum. I will not have a chair's verbal report. Item 6 for adoption en bloc. We have item 7, additions and amendments to delegations. Item 8, quarterly forward procurement report. And then item 9, out of session information papers to note.
No.
Councillor Martin, which one?
All three. No.
All two? There's only two.
Yeah, no, I'm asking just for a request related to monthly engagement.
Okay, that's fine. So item 9 is out at this stage. Can I have someone move on block items 7 and 8 at this stage? Councillor Milani, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Any debate? All those in favour? All those against? Those are carried. Item 9, Councillor Martin, you're moving as...
Moving as...
Can I have a seconder, please? Councillor Moran. Councillor Martin, you have the floor.
Yeah, look, all I'm asking is that if it would be possible to have a briefing about the expanded North Adelaide parking consultation and the frame bikeway consultation at some stage.
Yes, you will. Would you like an individual private briefing?
A private briefing. Councillor Clearahan might wish to attend.
Yes, that's fine. Well, I'm sure the CEO can take that on notice. Any other debate, members? Be it that there is none, Councillor Martin, to sum up.
Summed up.
All those in favour? All those against? That is carried. Item 10, any other items? Be it that there is none, I move to item 13 and I close the meeting at 8 p.m. Woo-hoo! 1 minute. 1 minute.